Okay, so we're back here. We're going to start planning, do the pre-planning preparations we need to do for Elusive Victory. We're going to be doing, we're planning out scenario EV4 Alert Five on the 10th of October, 1967. So let's go ahead and take a look and see what that's going to entail for us here. See if I can get that for you. See if I can sort of flatten it out. I got a little angle going on, so we'll see how I do here. So, I briefly went over the scenario last time, I think, when I was doing sort of a general introductory video of Elusive Victory. But now let's actually go over it more in detail because we're actually going to begin planning the scenario. It's not a very large one, but I think it'll tackle a lot of the concepts and designs the game has in general. We won't be necessarily hitting every point, for example, because we're going to have a pretty small raid, very low amount of flights, as you'll see in a second. And we won't be using things like the fire can units or advanced surface-to-air missile units, the SAM units. So none of the SA-2s or SA-7s, none of the Hawks that the IAF can use. And we won't be bringing in any infantry or tank units that honestly barely move on the map at all, but do have flak and anti-air capabilities. Won't be doing that. So this won't be a totally comprehensive look, but it should be enough that especially if you're getting started with the game, this is just sort of the procedure you'll go through. Even with a bigger raid, it'll just be more complex, more planning, more sheets we'll fill out. So enough babbling. Let's just get on and talk about it. So first thing you have here is the background, and sort of what this tells us here is that we are like much of the game here, we're not really using actual battles necessarily because these sort of combats at this scale were so tactical that it'd be difficult to really get a very accurate recreation of a famous battle because literally most battles in this game take, a long raid would take maybe 30 game turns or 40, and that's 30 or 40 minutes. So it's difficult to actually capture a battle that happened maybe in 5 or 10 minutes like this one might. This is a sandbox kind of battle. It sort of recreates what was a typical raid that the Egyptian Air Force would launch on Israeli positions. So we can see here that this actually says that to improve the protection of Israeli troops in the Sinai, a Mirage 3CJ alert detachment was established on the 26th of July at the Rephidim Air Base, which was a former Egyptian air base, but the Israelis had managed to seize it. And they were using it sort of as a forward operating place to sort of project air cover and air power. So what this raid is going to simulate is we're going to actually have what would be the Egyptian Air Force sort of conducting a strike raid on this airfield to try to shut it down or damage it. And we're going to have the Israeli response using these Mirage 3CJs. What this says up here is that eventually that they had sort of a flight of 3CJs always on alert, and they actually scored their first kill. When was it? October 67, the first kills for that alert detachment were scored. So this sort of represents maybe what would have been their first kills in this sort of scenario. Every scenario in this book will actually have a similar layout here. We have the background sort of just for fun. The targets, this is exactly what the raiding player, sometimes both players will be raiding, but this is usually what the attacking player must do. So we have here our targets are going to be the Rephidim airfield. And we have three different targets, as you can see here. We have the airfield runway, the control tower, and the aircraft revetment, I'm guessing facilities. And they all occupy the same hex, so we tell you what hex here. And you can see here the profile, it determines how difficult it is to damage it. As we can see here, the control tower will probably be the easiest to damage. But the runway, because it exists, we can actually arm some of our flights with runway dribblers, which give us 3 times the attack on runways alone. So maybe we might go after the B runway, but the C tower looks pretty easy. And it says here that the EAF player must attack one or more available targets at Rephidim. So we have to at least attack one target. The date for this will be the 10th of October, 67. Time of the day is going to be 6 o'clock at night, so getting kind of dusk. In fact, it even says that weather dusk. The detection level for the IAF will be C, and the EAF will have D. It's not really going to come into a lot of play here, although we will be rolling detection rolls on the incoming EAF flights. So C is not great, but it's not terrible. And we'll actually look at the charts later that come in the various player aids to see where detection happens when we actually do it. The GCI level, which is ground control, I believe intercept level, this basically determines how many cap flights you could have, and honestly, this is says IAF2, EAF0, so the EAF won't be able to have a cap flight, but they'll have a strike flight. That's what they're going to have, a raid, a bombing flight. But if we had more flights for the Israelis, and we could field more than just one flight of Mirages, then we couldn't have more than two cap flights, two of our flights be designated for cap missions. Anything over two, and we would actually lose a detection level. We'd go down to D. This really represents the ground control ability to keep tabs of the battle and also just really know where flights are. It's not easy looking at a radar screen and trying to sort blips and whatnot out. So this sort of represents the fact that that's just about how many flights they can handle reasonably and also direct. And so that's why that has a whole cap and reducing detection level rule. It's gonna be dusk. Open airfields will tell you which airfields the raiding player can use and what kind of flights can take off and land there. As you can see here, we have Cairo West, Fayed, Inches, and Kibrit. Only Cairo West, which we'll see later at the top of the map, can have both MiG-17s and MiG-19s. MiG-19s are better air combat platforms, whereas the MiG-17 is sort of a general do-all platform, not very good at anything. It's kind of a slow pig, but it can actually hold air-to-ground ordnance. The MiG-19 cannot. So something to think about here. We're not going to get a whole lot of options on how we want to build our flights, but we do have some of these airfields to play with. We see here the order of battle that the tells you kind of what they get. The IAF player is going to get one flight of four Mirage 3 CJs. That's what that means. One times four means one flight, four planes in that flight. They're going to be on cap, and they're going to be on quick ready alert at refightem. So essentially, they're going to be ready to launch at a moment's notice. Some flights, in some scenarios, you'll have to designate if you want them to start ready or not. Some will have to actually be brought into the process of being ready and then take off. So this is where you'll learn whether or not your flights can actually be ready to go, or if you have to plan them or have them take off at a certain turn. This is where you'll see that. We're going to get 4 points of AAA for the ground units, and we'll talk about that in a second as we plan our AAA. And our pilot quality is going to be veterans for the Mirage. That's pretty good. We're going to roll for what they call the pilot aggression level soon. And you'll see how this actually works into that. So veteran means they're going to have probably higher aggression levels. The AAF is going to have what they have here, basic maps. This is MiG allocation points, I believe, and they have 20. So we'll talk about that in a second. We have 20 points to play with to buy our flights. We can have up to two dummy flight markers. Probably won't be using that because this will be a tutorial, but if you were trying to fake out the Israeli player, very good use of dummy flights is key. And it tells you right here the available aircraft types in the MiG-17F and the MiG-19S. And our pilot quality is going to be trained. So not green, but again, not veteran level like the Israelis are going to field. Some of the special rules for the scenario, the north and south map is going to be used north of column 19XX, and that's way off the map here. I mean, I could show you that. It's pretty ridiculous. We have pretty much the whole map to play with. IAF flights may not cross the Suez Canal to Egypt, or they lose VPs. So essentially, we just need to chase flights away or engage them, but we cannot follow them all the way back if they go to an airfield deep into Egyptian territory. That sort of makes sense for what the scenario is, right? This is not a pursue flight. This is really just a cap. It's just combat air patrol trying to keep the skies clear, trying to project power and sortie against any incoming raids. The Israeli player must set up AAA within two hexes of 4049. 4049 is going to be the airfield. And so we're kind of limited where we can set our AAA up, but that's not a big deal. Visibility is reduced to two hexes due to dusk. Again, that will come into detection issues. We'll see how that works out, but we know it's two hexes. The IAF may not take off until an EF flight has entered a Sinai hex or is detected. So we can have our flights on ready alert status, as it says up here, but they actually cannot take off until the flight has entered the Sinai or it becomes detected, which may happen in the first round. We'll see. If the random event, because we'll roll a random event on every turn except the first, if it is a 6, 10, 19, or 20 is rolled, treat it as a non-event. So we'll see what that is when we roll it, if we do. And the last rule is the IAF player may split his formation on the ground into two flights of two Mirage 3 CJs. And that's just in case we want to, it's just something you can do if you want to. So we'll see what kind of options that presents later. The victory conditions is going to be standard ones, so we'll see at the end. It's nothing special. The exceptions are, of course, one minus one VP for any Israeli flight that crosses into the Suez Canal or into Egypt. And there's no VP loss for failure to conduct a battle damage assessment. In more complex and larger raids, you have to schedule a recon flight when you're done bombing. It has to come in so many turns after you've bombed the target. Usually it tells you within so many turns you have to conduct a recon. And all that really involves is just having your recon flight just buzz by it and buzz over the top, and that counts as recon. Because essentially, in tactical air combat, you don't really know how much damage you've done until you can actually get an assessment, and until you actually know how much you've damaged the target, you don't know if you need to scramble more flights out or not. So this is just a simple raid, so they're not really into seeing how much damage they did. They're really just there to harass Israeli forces, and if they can, get lucky and knock the airfield out for a time. So yeah, very simple, not too complicated. That's kind of why I picked it. Just a couple of flights. We do get some triple A. We get to pick a little things and decide if we're going to arm our guys. So that's actually pretty interesting. So anyway, I just want to roll over that and show you that's what we're going to do. Okay, so... nice. The first thing we're going to need to do, since we've gotten all this, is we're going to need to start purchasing our units for the EAF. So we get 20 points, and we have the availability of the MiG-17 or the MiG-19. So let's take a look at those right now. All right, so here's the EAF aircraft data chart. It's going to have all those various figures and stats for all of the aircraft that you can potentially use. Pardon me. So our options are the MiG-17F and the MiG-19S. So it's the very first two available. Some of the stats here, like how many crew it contains, each have one, how much fuel points they have. Remember, we use fuel points when you go to dash throttle or you engage in air-to-air combat. And so the MiG-17 has 12 fuel. So, and it's the air-to-ground attack platform. It can do, I think it has guns. Yeah, it has guns. It can strafe. But it's really made for just air-to-ground combat attack. So it has 12 fuel because, of course, it can be laden and go slower. It's going to need more fuel to get going. The bomb value here, this is sort of its multiplier it uses for when it uses bombs. It's a 0.5 multiplier. So this is not an aircraft you really want to necessarily use if you want to do big damage, but it has the potential to carry bombs and carry out those kind of missions. Not going to be the most effective. This is the bomb site modifier. As you can see, the MiG-19 and the MiG-17 don't give any modifiers for the bomb sites. So again, kind of indicative of the fact this is not the aircraft you want to use if you want to do big time damage. And of course, it doesn't have any jamming or what's RAR? I'll have to look this up. But it does not impact us here. As you can see, really, that only comes into effect with other planes down there. And then we have clean and laden values for their speed, for combat, dash, and this is their maneuver. Combat and dash is just moving across the map and how fast you can. Maneuver is used when you get into air-to-air combat, and this essentially dictates how many shots you can potentially get off. What kind of ordnance can it have? This one can actually have runway dribblers, another ordnance, which is actually nice. That's pretty much what we're going to be equipping it with. That's what the MiGs do. Air-to-air combat, we have a 23 to 37 millimeter gun here. That's not too bad. Not going to be that great, but it's something, right? So we can actually strafe on targets if we run out of bombs or have to drop them if we get into combat. So let's see if I can find the chart that tells us how much we have to pay for these things. All right, so this actually just has that data. Player aid card. I meant to look this up. Oh. Is this it? Nah, here we go. So on player aid card 2, let me get that back up there. Here we go. MiG purchase here. So it'll tell you the cost of things, and this is how you can do it. So we have 20 points, and essentially you can see here they make it real nice and easy for you. So you can see that if we wanted to have MiG-17, we could have two flights of four MiG-17s for 10 each, right? So it'd be 20 points total. Or we could kind of mix in some MiG-19s. They're a little more expensive because they're more air combat types, right? So a whole flight of four MiG-19s would be 15 points. So we could kind of mix and match and maybe say have a flight of three MiG-19s and a flight of three MiG-17s. That would be 20 points. We could do a whole mix and match of whatever we wanted to do. That's sort of the whole point of getting our points to spend. And when you're filling that out, what you want to do is you want to get your handy-dandy flight sheet out. And this is where we're going to actually record all of our flights. Now, normally in a game, each player would have one of these, and they would keep it secret for themselves and fill it out. And this is sort of their master sheet that lists what counter the flights can be represented by. Because if you remember, or as you'll see, flights come in undetected, and they sort of have generic counters. So you have to know which counter belongs to what flight. It has its call sign. Its aggression level, what kind of mission it's on, things like that. So, yeah, and then we have a gun and other various things. This keeps track of your ammo. This keeps track of your flights here. So if you have one, two, three, four, and one gets damaged, there's ways to mark that on here. This is sort of your master sheet that keeps track of everything. So I think we're going to start filling this out now. Because I think what we're going to do is we're going to kind of keep it simple. Like I could do some pretty interesting MiG-19, MiG-17 combos, but I think I'm just going to overwhelm them with just pure force. And we're going to do two flights of four each of MiG-17F. So we're going to have to spend all 20 points. We're going to get two flights of MiG-17s. So what I do is I go to my sheet here and I say, okay, I'm going to get two MiG-17s. It is. So we'll just go ahead and do that here. And then what I'll do is I'll sort of come and pick out. Well, first I want to pick which counters I want to actually use for my MiG-17s, right? So I'll just pick two of them here at random, right? I got a heart and a green diamond there. That's Shirara. Maybe I should pick what I actually pronounce. It's pretty bad. Sorry. Yeah, okay. There's Hafiz, and that's, was that Al-Masiri? So these are our two MiG-17 counters. Oh, you can probably just barely see those, right? Yeah, there they are. So we'll make those our MiG-17s. Let me get that back in here. So what we'll do is we'll say, so we have these two. So what we do need to do is we need to pick a generic counter that has, well, essentially what we'll do is we'll pick a generic counter that has a diamond and a heart on it, but it'll have the undetected side first up. So what we need to do is look for that. So that works. We got a heart sign counter there, and we need a diamond side counter here. All right, see, and what'll happen is they'll come in, they'll start off undetected and have KY undetected. So, yeah, we'll make Hafiz here. He actually will be a counter K. We'll make Al-Masiri here counter Y. I have a funky Y there. And we'll go ahead and fill this out here and say Hafiz Al-Masiri. Okay. So we've picked out our units, we've picked out the kind of counters we want. Now what we're going to need to do is we're going to need to, I believe, roll for their aggression. Oh, I need to plan out the flight thing, but we'll go ahead and, there's little phases. This is all can be, this is all pre-planning stuff, so you kind of do any way you like. The way the rules say we should do it is that we should purchase our flights, we should begin the planning phases and decide what they're going to do. And start playing out their routes, but I think we'll do that next. I think what I'm gonna do now is get their flight quality generation. So this has a lot to do with just generally how good the unit will be. It's sort of its morale rating, right? So what we need to do is we need to roll on the flight quality chart, which is probably gonna be in that blue one, I'm guessing. There are a lot of charts in this game. I mean, it has to be. It's an air combat game. You're just naturally gonna have that. Ah, there it is. The flight quality table. So what we're going to do is we're going to roll two, and we're going to compare it to what we have here: trained, regular, veteran, ace. So I guess trained really is the lowest level quality. So that's actually pretty funny. I thought there was actually maybe a green level, but there isn't. So that's pretty interesting there for the old Israelis or Egyptians, I should say. All right, so we'll roll for the first one. Let's roll for Hafiz. All right, he's got a nine and a seven, so that's what, 16. So he gets a zero. He gets a zero aggression level. Now we'll roll for Al-Masiri. It's a nine. And that means he gets a negative one aggression. All right. Let's go ahead and take a look. So the thing is, the Israelis are just going to be one flight. They're going to be this Mirage flight, which I guess I should pull up to the. Oh, this is it. Yeah. So we're going to use Spectre here. Oop, get you on the camera there, Spectre. So we'll put him on here. Normally we do a lot more of it, or we keep it separate, right? But we'll just keep it together and just we'll slot him down one just so we know this is Israelis. And he's actually going to use counter 106. Ooh, let me make sure I got that on there. 106. Cool. So what we'll do is we'll say counter 106 is going to be Spectre. Oh, that's where he is up here. This is actually a Mirage. I bet that's what you write here at aircraft type. Oh well. And let's roll for his aggression. Now he is actually rated as, I believe, what did our scenario thing say? I think he said he was a veteran. Yeah, he's a veteran. So let's roll on his chart. Ooh, he rolls a nice 15. So 15 for a veteran is plus 2 aggression. So yeah, he's actually quite the aggressive guy. Okay, so we've actually planned out which markers we're going to use. We have it all set up here. We know we got K, Y, and 106. So we'll go ahead and hold these guys off to the side for now. All right, so let's go ahead and outfit our units here. The Mirage, I believe, can only carry, let's take a look at its aircraft, let's take a look at the IAF aircraft data chart. So I believe the Mirage does have radar, it has recon, it has lots of air-to-air weapons, and it can carry ordnance, air-to-ground ordnance, but we won't actually be using the air-to-ground ordnance, we'll actually be using some of these. So let's see what we can actually get here. Air-to-air weapon. Let me look at this. So, yeah. So actually, let's just keep it here. This is probably the best way to think about what we can actually get. So we can have the Matra 530, the Shafir, the AIM, or the 30mm gun. It always carries with it. So let's take out the Matra, Shafir, and the AIM. We come here. We'll actually see what those are. So the Matra is a, yeah, it's like a radar missile, yeah, successful system, yeah, it was a radar homing missile, essentially, and it was sort of unsuccessful, not as good as they wanted it to be. And then there's the Shafir, this is a infrared missile, I believe, right? Was this, the Shafir was ineffective? Yeah. Is this the one? What is this? The IRM? What's an IRM? I don't really know flight lingo, unfortunately. Sorry. I should know this. Probably not to look it up. I look like a moron. IRM is 1.3. Oh, here's a glossary of terms. It's very nice. That is an infrared missile, yeah. So I should have known that. Anyway, that's an infrared missile, and this is a heat-seeking sidewinder. So what we want to do is we kind of want to look at what's going to give us the most damage, or what's going to be the best to fire at guys. And I think, some of these won't be available, so it'll tell you the air-to-air weapons here. And so we can take anything from 67... and before, so we're going to actually have to take the AIM missiles. We can't take anything better. The Matra is available. The AIM is available, the lesser one, but we won't be able to use the Shafir or the Sparrow. I don't think. AIM 7? Yeah, we won't be able to use that. So all we have really actually is the Matra or the old AIM Sidewinders. Or do we? What's the RS3? What is this one? I guess it's an infrared missile. I guess I don't know why I can't have that. Essentially, we can have the Shafir, the Matra, or the RS3. So I think what we'll do is, just to keep it real easy, we'll do the Matra. We'll just say they have that one, they had a radar homing missile. So we'll go ahead and give him a full load of Matras. And that is an infrared. Yeah, so here's where we fill that out. So we decide we're going to give him the actually, it's a radar homing missile, my bad. The Matra. And I believe we'll get a full thing. So yeah, we don't have to worry about ordnance or any of that stuff. And his tasking, he is on cap. I guess that's sort of, fill that out, crew is one. All right, okay. And how much fuel does the Mirage have? Let's take a look at that. So Mirages, make sure I still got this one. Yeah, okay. A Mirage has, how much fuel? 6. So yeah, it's really just a simple air-to-air fighter. Can't really go too far, do too much, because it would run out of fuel pretty quick. So we'll go ahead and note that over here, right? 6 fuel points. And then both our MiG-17s have 12, I believe, right? Yeah, save 12. Okay. Just taking little notes for me to know. For the MiGs, we're going to give them runway dribblers. That's going to be their entire air platform. They have guns. They do have a 30-millimeter gun. I guess I should write that down for the old Mirage, huh? Because the Mirage does have guns as well. It has a 30-millimeter gun. So we'll go ahead and do that here. 30-millimeter, and then my MiG-17s have. We're going to give them runway dribblers. It's RD, RD. And then they're going to also have guns. And their guns are going to be what? Where is my sheet? Oh, it's hidden under here. So their guns are going to be 23 37-millimeter guns. One's 2337, I wonder. Yeah. We'll give them 23s. I don't know if they're supposed to have 23, 30, whatever things. We'll just call it that. So we'll say 23 M. M. Sorry about the shaking. This table's, it can get shaky. Sorry about that when I write. Okay, so yeah, we got our little flights planned out here. We've written down things we want. Okay, so we got what we picked out what we want to do. So now we actually get to the more fun part. I mean, it's fun outfitting your stuff. That's always fun. Now let's talk about AAA, because we actually get some points to spend on AAA. We get, what is it, 4 points. Okay, so let's find our AAA table. Oh, I bet that's in the blue one. So it seems like the. It seems like player aid card one has a lot of the battle charts you're going to need. And it looks like player aid card two is going to have more of the, like, here's the random events table. Let's see, there's the SAM. It's got like the, yeah, it's got the SAM tables, all that stuff. We need the FLAC. Huh. Is that not in here? It sure isn't. I kind of thought that was in there. All right, so we need to do. Yeah, where is that? Where is our FLAC purchase? Right into the first thing that I thought I had good to go here, and I'm talking a lot, so that's probably not good. Oh, there's just way too many rules. All right, I gotta take a break until I figure out what I'm doing here. And when I come back, we'll talk about plaque. Okay, I found it. It's right here. It's on 14.11 AAA points. So you get to place them on the map. Some are already on there, and you can upgrade them. But you can place them for light is 1, medium is 2, and a heavy is 4 points. And then you can upgrade them. Light can go to medium for 1 additional point, and medium can go to heavy for 2 points. So we get 4 points of spin. So either we can put 4 light ones around, 2 mediums, or 1 heavy, or a medium and 2 lights. But we have to keep them within 2 hexes of our airfield. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to pick 2 mediums. Let's go ahead and do that. We're going to use up all 4 of our points. And what you would do here is you put this on the sort of aircraft alert planning sheet. And because some of your AAA can show up hidden or start hidden, and this is where you would record it. And if the flight flew over it or got within one of the hexes, the FLAC hexes, because a FLAC hex is its hex and any of the hexes around it, kind of like a zone of control, it's just a FLAC zone. So this is where you would keep it all noted. So what we're going to do is we're going to have 2 type mediums. Man, this really does get so shaky if I write. That's really annoying. That's really annoying. Anyway, so let's take a look where we want to put these. We're going to put medium ones down. Where do we want to put them? So let's actually take a look at our hex here. So this is the airfield hex, and some of the starting places I'll show you later, but this is the actual target hex right there. And you can kind of see this is where the two map sheets overlay, and I didn't quite get it perfect, but close enough. So we can actually put things within 1, 2, so this sort of barrier around here. And let's go ahead and take a look at our medium. That's what we need. That's a FLAC. I have a medium FLAC. So it's a heavy FLAC. Light, heavy, medium. There we go. two lights. Oh, I need a medium. Okay, good. It's like, is that going to be one of those annoying things? Okay. So we have two, and we don't need that. It's the blue one. Actually, technically, I guess this is... I guess blue is Israeli, isn't it? I'm kind of doing that backwards, aren't I? So, damn. All right, hold on. All right, there's two mediums. All right. There we go. Let's actually use the right counters for the right things. So I think what we'll do is we... Kind of what you want to do when you're placing your AAA is anticipate sort of routes that they're going to take, right? So one of the things I know, for example, that I haven't talked about here is the airfields that'll be open. So I know that like Kibrit will be open, Fayed will be open, Cairo or Cairo West, which is way up there, is open, and so is this one, Inches, that red one there. So that one, I guess I'll go ahead and mark these guys. Let's go Fayed and Kibrit. So those airfields, and then there's the target, right? So we have our target here. So you can see that there's quite a lot of airspace up there. It's a pretty direct line. And we know that when they come down, they're going to have to come down, fly over the target, and then fly back. So some of the things I'm thinking about is that there's some naturally rough terrain here, which they could use to sort of hide their radar signatures either coming in or leaving. But it's really clear otherwise. So I think what we'll do is let's go ahead and flak medium. And we'll go ahead and put, a medium. We'll go ahead and put a medium flak there. And that way we can kind of get some nice coverage here. Actually, I might put that guy there. Yeah, let's just do that. Let's actually do that. I like how this works. Then I'll have the whole flak coverage there. I'll have another little zone there. Won't be a whole lot of ways. You'll have to take a lot of flak either if you go through it or whatnot, so. I actually like that placement. So here's when we would note where the flak placement is if we were going to keep it hidden. I'm not going to necessarily keep it hidden, but just so you know, on the sheet, this is where you would write it out. So I'd say like, oh, type in that first one, hex 3949, you know, and then I would note that it's a medium flak and all that jazz. So anyway, we don't get a whole lot of points, but I think we'll just do that. We'll keep that there. Be a nice little better view maybe of what's going on. Okay, so that's AAA. That's our points we could spend there. Let's see, and we don't have any other SAM types. We don't have any other kind of ground defense because there's a whole other sheet where you would get that you could fill this out. And I found these all on Board Game Geek. Terry Simo has placed all these on there for download, so you can grab these and print them yourself. It's very nice of him to do that. So this is where you fill your like more sophisticated SAM defense things with your. Basically with your more sophisticated SAM platforms, but we don't need to do that. Okay, so we've bought our AAA, we've got our aircraft fitted out, so let's actually talk about the raid. This is where it gets really fun, right? Because we only have one player doing a raid, so this is where you actually get to plan the fun stuff. So if you remember, raids are kind of important because the path you take, largely your raiding flights have to remain within two hexes, your bombing flights do, of that raid planning sheet, or of your raid that you're going to plan. And normally you would get a sheet like this, and it has a miniature map it's a miniaturized version of the map, right? And this is where you would secretly plot all of your complex things. Because as you can see, you can get some pretty complex flight paths going on here, right? We're going to do a relatively simple one, and I'm going to just keep it on the plexiglass here. But this is, you would make copies of this, and this would be your planning map. I think instead what we're going to do is we're just going to, let me bring this guy over. I think what we'll do is we'll just sort of, we don't need to actually have a planning map necessarily. I think we can just do this on here, mainly because it's a tutorial game, so I think I'm just going to actually plot it out. I kind of drew one out, I think, in the introductory video. But we'll go ahead and just sort of plan out a new one here. So we have two flights of MiGs, right? So where's our MiG boys? Let's go ahead and bring these guys out. Let's think about what they can do and what they're going to do. So we have the Israeli flight here. It's going to start there. It actually will have its, technically we wouldn't know what it is. So it would be a question mark, right? And we would keep this off to the side, right, hidden away. So we have our flight 106 question mark. And then we have, let's get our flat guys out of the way here. All right, so then we have our two MiG flights, which are going to be represented by K and Y, respectively. So I think what we'll do is We could do one of two things. I could have two flights take off from here at different turns and do their sort of route, or I could have them take off individually from each of these airfields and sort of come down to that and create their own little raid paths. I'd have to create my own special raid path for that guy and a raid path for this guy. Just to keep it simple, and because that's really what I want to do, is make this a very simple sort of tutorial. As I let dog hair get all over the map. I think what we'll do is we'll just have them both take off from Kibrit, and we'll actually just have them take off at different turns. So essentially, we'll have one go one turn, and then one come very much the next turn. So essentially, it'll be a quick takeoff, right? So what we'll do is we'll say Kibrit is the starting hex, and you have to plan straight lines and turns and where you're going to do it, and the altitude changes. So let's do that all here. The target is down here. I need to sort of plan a plot that's going to get me around and back up. So, and the other thing I have to keep in mind is I have to actually look at which way the runway is going, because that's how you take off and land. So flights have to come along this line there, okay? Because of the way the runway is set up. So I think what we'll do is we'll start here. And we're going to come down. We're actually going to come down and try to get across some of this rough terrain, just because that kind of can help us if we stay low. We're going to want to get kind of low anyway as we do our approach. So try to stay off the radar, try to get away from here, because our MiG-17s are not very good at high altitudes. In fact, they have zero ratings at the high altitude. We want to keep them at low to medium, because that's going to where they get their best values from. So what we're going to do is we're going to take off. We're going to come down here, I think. And we'll turn here. And we'll call this the turn point. And then we'll come down here. Sort of thinking where I can get a nice run on this guy. Yeah. Okay, so we'll see. Yeah, he'll come down here. And we'll turn there. We'll begin our bombing run at where this flak is. So that's our initial point for the bombing run, because the profile we're going to use, I think, is just going to be a dive bomb or straight bombing, and you just have to have a one hex initial point for that. So he'll bomb, he'll come down here, and he will go here, and then he'll turn, and then we're going to come back up here. See, I wouldn't normally know that the flak is there, right? So I could go a little further, but the truth is I'm not trying to stay in this airspace too long, because I'm afraid of the mirages sort of coming in and getting me here. So I'm going to turn here, come up, because I want to get one hex past the target, come turn here, and then we're just going to, like, engage dash throttle and just run. And we'll turn here. And then come back there. So we have one, two, three, four, five waypoints. That's fine. And a bombing target. We actually can't have, I believe, more than five or six waypoints. That's a lot of little turns there, but it's going to actually work out. And hopefully we'll be able to get back in one piece, right? So relatively simple flight plan here. I think what we'll do is we'll have, so let's take a look at our raid sheet. Where did I put you, raid sheet? That's my counter sheet. Oh, the raid plan sheet, I haven't pulled it out. Okay. That's why I'm probably thinking about this. So we have it all planned out here. And this is where we would write down everything we need to do. So we'll say this is EV4. This is the EAF. This is raid. Oops, I got the markers in here, don't I? Make sure you can still see that. This is raid number one, baby. And the target hex is going to be 4049. The rally hex is in more complex raids. If your flights become disorganized, which is a result that can happen because of combat, if they proceed to the rally hex and orbit there or sort of hang out there, they get a much better modifier for getting rid of their sort of disorganized status. So if you had more complex missions, you would actually plan a rally hex. And rally hexes have to be at, like, sort of natural landmarks, I believe. I'd have to look up the specific rule off the top of my head. I'm thinking any river section, or maybe any airfield, or any sort of. There's not really other geographical landmarks here, so it pretty much has to be a something that they could visually sight as a pilot and know that they could go there and figure out where they're at again, and then sort of resume what they were doing. So we sort of figure out what the flight here. So we actually know that because we filled out our little flight sheet earlier. So we're going to say that, what is it, flight K will take off on turn one. And we're going to have flight K, and flight Y will take off on turn two. And the target will be, well, we know the target's 4049. We'll see what they actually attack there when they get there. I think we're going to do the runway. And we're going to use runway dribblers, which I forgot to equip, but we'll figure that out in a second on our planes. We need to write down that we actually are going to give them runway dribblers. So we look at the flight route here, and we basically would fill that out here. We would say, okay, it's going to take off here. So the first code would be takeoff. And then we could actually kind of segregate this out and say, oh, this is going to be the K route, or we could say Y is going to follow the same thing just one turn later. And this is where you plan out the altitude, right? So we'd say, oh, okay, takeoff hex, what is this, Cabrillas 30, 35, 36. And you would say it's going to be heading, what is that? I guess that way is north, so this would be southeast. And the altitude we're going to keep them at is going to be deck. I think we'll just keep them at the deck for now. Makes them much more harder to detect. And I don't know how many MPs are going to be using. I think we'll probably just dash throttle it or something. What is their dash throttle? If it's laden, its dash is going to be 3 at low and 4 at medium. So it actually gets a little bit faster if we can do it at medium. So maybe we will keep them at medium because we're going to need to go for speed, I think, here. Oh, man, it's really moving so much. I'm really sorry about the shakiness. I ordered I ordered a tripod or whatever for my phone, so I actually have like a more stable thing instead of this rinky-dink holder I've been using now. So sorry about the movement. I know it's kind of really annoying to see shaky camera. Anyway, yeah, so he's gonna basically take off and he's gonna immediately go to dash throttle at 4. So it's gonna be 4 movement points. I guess technically when you take off, you actually can only move... I guess we can start already in the air. It's not really going to be a takeoff. It's really going to be kind of like the initial point. Or actually, it's the ingress. When you have the scenario, you can start... When you're the attacker, you can start in the air. So we're going to take advantage of that. Otherwise, takeoff requires a 3-turn process. The first turn, you put the marker on the airfield. The second turn, you can move 1/2 of your MPs. And on the third turn, you can move the full amount of MPs. Do game one. And we're going to do the same thing here, right? I guess technically, this would be the second flight. All right, so he goes there. He's going to head to hex, what is this? 3138. And this is a waypoint hex. This is WP1. And his heading, he will be heading east. And here we will still stay medium. Going to be using that dash throttle, and hopefully that's, what is that going to be? That's actually game turn two. That's perfect, so it'll be able to turn there, and so forth and so on, and we would plan this all out that way. I won't do that actually now, because we actually just have it written down on the map here. I think what I'll actually do, though, to make it a little easier to remember is it will say, because think about bombing runs, because these guys are going to be tasked with bombing. They're not going to be cap or any other kind of task. They're literally tasked for bombing, so they have to adhere to the bombing route, and they have to adhere to the elevation levels that we tell them to use. If they get attacked, they can immediately deviate from that and start doing whatever they want, but that's sort of, you don't really want to get attacked. You might lose your bombs or whatnot. So we'll say medium here, stay medium here. I guess we're just going to stick with medium. There's really not a whole lot of options because my flight really can't hang out too high, right? I guess we could go low here and sort of hopefully get some radar, because when you go over rough terrain, if you're on low, you can get lost in the radar. But honestly, that's not, because we have to climb and we're not going to really want to do that. So I think what we'll do is we'll stay medium on this leg as well. And then the goal would just be to dash sort of that. So I guess we're really just gonna stick with medium all the way. If I had a flight that could actually do more stuff and be more maneuverable, I might go to low and just kick it out of there. But I guess if I'm clean and I use all my stuff, doesn't really matter. I could be a low, medium, or high. Okay, so that's what we'll do. When we come to this point, we'll go to low just so we can get out of here. Because low also is just easier for us. We get better maneuverability and attack, so we'll try to stay that way. So to recap, we'll have turn one, the first flight. We'll go ahead and make that K. KY, right? We'll make K take off first turn. It will come here and do all of its maneuvers that we want to. We're actually going to keep this at medium. Dash. Do I want to do dash? How many fuel points do I have? That's a great question. So I have 12 fuel points, and every time I use dash, I'm going to use one fuel point. He can only move four, so that's going to be what? One, two, three, four. Yeah, so I can't do it all the time. So I think what we'll do is we'll just have to keep it medium. I think we're just going to have to go combat. And what we'll do is we'll do dash here. And definitely dash here. I think we have to go to combat here just so we can get landing. Yeah, so that'll work for me. I think we'll kind of maybe adjust on the fly since this is our first one and we got to kind of figure it out together because I really haven't played this essentially. So, I mean, we're learning together about what's going to be the best way to do this with the rolls and attacks and whatnot. So essentially, this is going to be my planned route here. I'm going to come over here, stay at medium level height, go to combat throttle, maybe come to dash here. I'm going to have to think about that. Stay at medium, bomb the target. Then when we come down, we're going to kick it down to low at 4250 and just dash the hell out of here and just try to get back, stay low, come back and land at Cabrit if we can. Hopefully the Mirages don't wreck too much havoc. All right, so I feel like I should have done the runway dribblers. I did write that down. Oh, yeah. And I'm going to have four bombs. I'm going to actually, so that's what they have here. So I did that right here. Runway dribbler. They're going to have that. Oh yeah, I got his missiles figured out. Okay, good. So we're totally set up here. I probably messed out some of these fields. This is my first time really doing that. I did a little bit of practice earlier, but you know, I was kind of just looking. I wasn't actually writing things down. So you got my first draft there. Well, let's make sure I'm not missing anything else for the raid planning. Let's see. We did flight quality. We had no early warning in this scenario. Sometimes you can. We don't have that. So just so you know, the AAA, I'm just going to go over those AAA rules because we kind of quickly did it here, right? But I just want to make sure that I discuss that. And basically in the ground deployment phase, all AAA upgrades and half of the number, all the AAA upgrades and half of the purchased AAA concentrations, not AAA points, right? The ones the actual buy, will be set up on the map. So anytime you upgrade an on-map AAA, it automatically gets known to the opponent. Ones that you purchase and put on the map are, up to half have to be placed, and the other half can be secret. So technically, I could have been like, you know, like 41, 48 could have kept that secret. And then as he comes over, I could have been like, oh, see ya, sucker. You know, like I got that flak unit there. SAMs are a little different. The scenario will specify the number of real SAM battalions that are located on the map. And they're all set up hidden. And Hawk batteries tend to have fixed locations, so they get known where they're at. But the EAF gets to choose when they want to turn on SAMs, and that's part of the game with SAMs because they have radar, right? So when you turn them on, they get show up on the map, and then they can be attacked, but necessarily you keep them hidden so you can actually get a good attack with them. This is where we put our aircraft in, which we're going to do. So I would say these are going to be ready. K is going to be the first flight. Mirage is ready to go. I would note if he's ready, unready, or revetted. If this was a longer scenario or something to go on, it could be possible some of our planes are getting revetted, right? But this guy's going to be ready to go. He's ready to take off, or he's actually already in the air when we have the start. Yeah, and then the IAF sets up their aircraft, and then basically you start doing game turns. So we've essentially planned out everything we have. So let's just go over it one more time. We're going to have two flights of MiG-17s. They're going to be equipped with run rate dribblers. And these are not going to be necessarily the best air-to-air combat. That's not what they're going to do. Their whole mission is really to fly in, hopefully don't get too harassed too much, and bomb the airfield or fight them, and then get the hell out. They have run rate dribblers. K will strike first or come in and take off first. Y will follow the next game turn that it can. And actually, that's going to be kind of funny because it would take three turns to take off. So I think that's it. I could start it at this airfield. I could have it just start at Faid, but we're going to keep it real simple, right? I didn't want to do two raid sheets and make it real complicated here. So I think what we'll do is say that K takes off, is already in the air on game turn one equals air. Y will come out game turn two, and that's just takeoff. And so that's actually going to take three turns for it to be like totally set, right? So it's going to be game turn two, it'll show up, and then actually game turn three, it'll start moving. So yeah, that could be very interesting for us. Okay, so yeah, have those two there. They're going to start undetected until they actually enter the Sinai, which is probably going to be this hex, I think. I think this still counts as the Suez. So that's going to be the first Sinai hex. And so if they enter that, they can be detected. They can also be detected just in the detection phase, which we'll talk about during the actual raid. Every turn you have a detection phase. It sort of represents your not on the map radar capability. And so it's possible these guys can be detected right away if they, when they take off or whatnot, or when they're in the air. But the first time we can actually start seeing what's up is when they enter a Sinai hex. We can actually use some of our own detection. Our flight can't launch until it does that. It's on quick launch, so it's ready to go. It'll just take off the moment they come out. So this flight will, of course, take... I have to look and see if it's on quick ready alert, if that means it takes three turns to take off still. Because at the first turn, of course, you have to place it. And I think it's already been placed, so I'm kind of guessing that is not how it works. But we'll find out when we do the actual raid. So we've got our path plotted out. You would do this, of course, on your own secret sheet. I'm just doing this on the Plexi because we're learning here. And then we'll come back and see if how this works. So, yeah, not a too complicated raid. I think it'll be pretty easy to carry out. We have minor flak. We've just got a couple of, we've got an air-to-air combat unit, some bombers. Yeah, it's going to be pretty interesting. So, yeah, I think that's really going to cover the pre-planning portion of this video. So when we come back, we'll actually launch the first raid for scenario EV4, right? What was that one called again? It is called... Alert 5. All right, so we come back, EV4, Alert 5.